How's everyone doing today? I've been fairly productive today, so I'm just happy to be here. Alright, day 17. Suddenly whirling in the distance, you notice what looks like a massive pixelated hurricane, a deadly spinlock. The spinlock isn't just consuming computing power, but memory too. Vast digital mountains are being ripped from the ground and consumed by the vortex. If you don't move quickly, fixing that printer will be the least of your problems. This spinlock's algorithm is simple but efficient, quickly consuming everything in its path. It starts with a circular buffer containing only the value 0, which it marks as the current position. It then steps forward through the circular buffer after some number of steps before inserting the new value 1. After the value it stopped on, the inserted value becomes the current position. Then it steps forward from there, same number of steps, and wherever it stops, inserts after it the second new value 2, and uses that as the new current position again. Uses this process of stepping forward, inserting a new value, and using the location of the inserted value as the new current position a total of 2017 times. So this value is the number of steps to take. I mean, I can just simulate this. This is easy to simulate. It wouldn't take very long. I mean, okay, I'll just do that then. Okay, so I'm not generating the right value. Okay, I just had my terms backwards. Not the right answer. Lygadia, thanks so much for the resub. I appreciate it. Did it roast me for cheating? Oh. Right answer for someone else. Interesting. Curiosity. Four 17. Isn't that the number I tied in? Typed in? Oh, you know what I'm messing up? Is that new element is supposed to be the new... current element. come on. Good news is that you've improved calculations for how to stop the spin lock. They indicate that you actually need to identify the value after zero. So I think the trick to this is rather than keeping the whole spin lock, which I don't really need, I can just keep track of what value would be after zero, right? Because I think if I try to do this 50 million times, I'm going to have an issue. Okay, so 0 is at index 0. The size of the buffer is 1. So I just need to simulate this process. What value would go after zero? And the successor to zero is currently nothing. Is that right? I mean, doing a loop 50 million times is really not that big of a deal as long as the thing I'm doing in that loop's pretty tight. So really all I need to do is first thing I need to do is I need to keep track of what my current index is. So my current index is going to go up by the input. And it's going to be modulo the buffer length. If the current index is equal to the index of 0, if current index is less than the index of 0, or less than or equal to? Is it possible for anything to ever get inserted before 0? I don't think it is. No. So 0 index is always at 0, never mind. So if current index is 0, that means this new element is going to get added at that location. So the successor is going to be I. And then the buffer length is going to go up. curiously it's the right answer for someone else. Stop. Oh, right. I think I'm making the same mistake again, right? The index then goes up by one. It's gotta stop implying I'm cheating or something. There's some way to do this faster. Guess I didn't need this. Does that actually speed it up at all? I don't imagine it really does. It's just one addition. Okay, anyway. Discover a tablet containing some strange assembly code labeled simply Duet. Rather than bother the sound card with it, you decide to run the code yourself. Unfortunately, you don't see any documentation, so you're left to figure out what the instructions mean on your own. Seems like the assembly is meant to operate on a set of registers that are each named with a single letter, and they can each hold a single integer. You suppose each register should start with a value of 0. There aren't that many instructions, so it shouldn't be hard to figure out what they do. Here's what you determine. Sound X plays a register, or plays a sound with a frequency equal to the value X. Set XY sets register X to the value of Y. Add XY. Mod. Recovers the frequency of the last sound played, but only when the value of X is not 0. Hey, thanks, Grimelius. Some of this seems annoying. Is it going to be better for me to pre-process these? I feel like whatever step two is going to be do this like a quadrillion times, and having pre-processed these will probably benefit me in some way. Hey, Clear Tonic. I've got some friends who are doing some of the 2020 problems together, like currently. I did a few of the 2020 problems. They're on my YouTube. But I like to do them in big batches. That's why I haven't touched 2021 yet, is because there's like only, what, 5 problems out now? It's the 5th. Is it worth it for me to pre-process these? I feel like it is. Whatever the next step is, it's going to be worth it to me. Alright, let's see if this gives me anything I can work with. Good enough, I guess. Whatever. We'll be right back.
Right?
This documentation's been on the back of the tablet this entire time. While you actually got most of the instructions correct, there are a few key differences. This assembly code isn't about sound at all. It's meant to be run at twice at the same time. What the fuck? This is actually a really good observation, that they could run at different speeds or run in sequence rather than parallel. It doesn't really matter. That hadn't really occurred to me. It means that it's easy for me to write this as just alternating back and forth between running the two programs. Yeah, I mean, I'll have to keep a separate program counter for both of them, because they have different states, so whether or not they jump might happen at different times. But ultimately, this is just a question of can you balance the states. This right here? Yeah, this is the mini-map. So I think this is fine. I just need to be able to identify when they're both locked, right? And that's any time that I come back to a program. If program is blocked and length of program.queue is equal to 0, then break. Can't set attribute because this is not a way that you can use name tuples. I'm getting too saucy right now. I think guess 127. There we go. A bit of a tedious problem to implement, but not bad. Just working on Advent of Code problems. Oh, please, God, tell me my input doesn't look like that. Oh, God. Thank you. Holy fucking shit. Fire Code is having a fucking time with this. I too am determined to go forward. Chocolate Dave, thank you so much for the subscription. Look at this mini map here. This is miserable. Okay, so I can trust that pluses are always my junction points. Good lord. I can't call strip on this. Can I just turn off Fire Code for a hot minute? Like, what? A tremor? Coding's going fine, and I'm looking forward to Might and Magic 7 as well. You're live coding, thanks so much for the raid. I assume you're into live coding. It picked the same direction to go back. Okay, so that's where it went wrong. This should be skipping over going in the same direction. Oh, yeah. No, that was my mistake. That's my error. This says going in the same direction. The issue's not going in the same direction, it's reversing. That'll have to do. Okay, so that did the right thing. Oh, I didn't need to print all that out. PAC is curious how many steps it needs to go. For example, using the same routing diagram from the example above, PAC would go 6 steps down, 3 steps right, 4 steps up, 3 steps right, 4 steps down. That's it? So I just need a counter? Let me bring back this example and make sure I don't have an off by one issue. Yeah, I thought I was gonna have an off by one error. Particle swarm. Suddenly the GPU contacts you asking for help. Someone has asked it to simulate too many particles, and it won't be able to finish them all in time to render the next frame at this rate. Transmits to you a buffer, your puzzle input, listing each particle in order, starting with particle 0, then particle 1, then 2, and so on. For each particle, it provides the XYZ coordinates for the particle's position, velocity, and acceleration in the format XYZ.
Woof.
Real physics gone sexual. Z buffering? Isn't that just like what order you draw things in? Yeah, your depth buffer. Man, they could have made this data easier to parse, I'll tell you that much. They chose not to. This problem doesn't seem enjoyable to solve. Trying to think of how you actually implement this. Is it just keeping a running best? Like you compare the first element against the second element, whichever's best, you compare that against the third element, and then how am I directly comparing them? I'm comparing them based on figuring out their trajectory. I just fast forward a ton of time steps and figure out. It's like not off up. It's not obvious to me what the solution is here. I'm actually a little stumped right now. This problem feels like it's well posed, but it's a little out of my wheelhouse doing this sort of like geometric problem like this. Possibly, but these all seem like they have, I mean, it would be a combination of one that has low velocity and low acceleration, but they all have some acceleration, and they all start with some velocity. I mean, if you've got no acceleration, wait, is that true? This, at a glance, seems to me like the sort of problem that I feel like I should feel confident in solving, but I'm not. It's not obvious to me how I approach this. Yeah. No, I take your meaning. I mean, I can try that. I can try whichever one has the lowest. I guess Manhattan acceleration would be the way to put that. It wouldn't be Manhattan acceleration, right? If by Manhattan acceleration you mean just adding the acceleration vectors together, I don't think it would be just that, right? Because, like, this adds up to zero, but that's not useful to me. Oh, it needs an absolute value on each term, you're right. Yeah, I'm... Everyone's correct. This looks like the current best one I'm seeing. If there's anybody out there with a 0.000 acceleration, that's the only thing that's gonna beat that. I mean, this has the lowest acceleration. Yeah, there could be another one. And that one. Alright, let me just code that up really quickly. That seems cheap, but who knows, maybe that works. Okay, that matched the last one on the line. Why is find all not working? Oh, huh, because there is only one on the line. Thanks. I'm just using Atom. It's a glorified text editor. Turns out that was correct. So I just need to solve for all pairs, whether or not they ever collide. Oh, this is interesting. This is time dependent. Oh, yeah, so that means that just detecting whether or not two particles collide doesn't matter. You need to detect whether or not it's the first collision that happens with that particle. Need to think for a moment. Okay, I'm gonna take a break for now. I got my show over on Smike's channel in about half an hour. And then tonight we're gonna start Might and Magic 8 over here. Or, sorry, Might and Magic 7 over here. So I'm gonna hit pause here. We made it through a handful of problems, not too bad. What problems did we finish? We did 17, 18, 19, and we were working on 20, so we've made good progress. I'm gonna let this be my stopping point for right now.